welcome to the show.
Thanks. It's great to great to have me on.
You are the founder and still CEO?
I'm still chairman. I'm not CEO.
Still chairman of Nike, which is a $30 billion a year company.
Yeah.
But from very humble beginnings, this company.
Very.
How did it begin, and how many years now has it been around?
Well, it started as a on the running track at the University of Oregon, where my old where my old track coach was always experimenting with shoes, which
so
sort of planted a seed. I was a distance runner, and he experimented with different shoes. And they had a lot of good runners, and they had me. So he experimented with me.
Because if something went wrong, you're no great
that's
loss.
That's right. He didn't want to screw up those good guys. And so that sort of planted a seed, and then I went on to the Graduate School of Business at Stanford and took a class in entrepreneurship, and I wrote a paper. The U.S. shoe market was being dominated by German shoe companies, Adidas and Puma, and it didn't make sense to me that you make shoes in Germany. So I said, why don't you make shoes in Japan like they did the camera business? So when I got done, I took a trip to Japan to call on a shoe company, and I placed an order for samples, and that was the beginning.
Now, I've got here what I've been told is the original waffle shoe. Mm-hmm. What is the significance of this Nike shoe right here?
This was a shoe that really put Nike on the map.
When you first started the company in, I guess, 1962, around then, mm-hmm. you knew nothing about shoe design. You didn't know a lot about management, and you didn't have any money. So today, the company is now worth roughly a market capitalization of about $100 billion, revenues of about $30 billion, 62,000 employees. Did you ever imagine, when you first started this company in the early 60s, that it could ever be what it became?
Sometimes when I get that question, I say, we're exactly on plan. But with you, I can't be a smartass.
But you mean that wasn't an original question? I thought that was the first person ever asked that. Okay.
No, but it's, it's been a ride that really nobody could foresee. That when we started out, the total branded athletic shoe sales in the United States were about $2 billion. So last year we did nine. And so based on the original year, we're 450% market share. So it's, we took advantage of the running boom, which became a jogging boom, which became a fitness boom. And we've benefited from all of that.
But at some point, they began to be competitive with you. So you began to build your own company called Nike. And you needed a symbol of the company. And mm-hmm. I guess somebody came up with this whoosh.
That's
so,
right.
So you paid $35 for that?
Yeah, it was a graphic arts student at Portland State who needed money.
Okay.
And we said, we'll pay you $2 an hour to practice, you know, to get some designs, and she spent 17 and a half hours on that.
Wow, okay, well, so $35, that's pretty good, okay. So,
it did have a happy ending, I hope you had that.
You gave her some stock.
When we went public, we gave her 500 shares of stock, and she has not sold a single share, and it's over $1 million now.
Wow.
Started back running, and I'm so excited because hello.
We have a little gift you just let us in with. Said, I've just started running again.
Yes.
And so you're asking me about shoes backstage?
No, I met Phil. And
so
then
I called up, and they got some shoes made for it.
Immediately.
So this is the Lunar Glide 2, which is the top of the line running shoe. And
wow.
Well, absolutely.
That was quick.
So it's got customized with your name on the toe, and all kinds
of
words.
It's called the Lunar Glide 2?
Lunar Glide 2.
Every year, you find a way to make the shoe better.
That's our job.
Listen,
They'll be more comfortable.
Than that. I'm gonna try these right now. Because, you know, I met Mr. Knight, and we'd never met before, but I come to the green room this morning with two of my different Nike shoes, and I was telling him about the shoe I was running in last night that did not. Oh, this is a shoe. This is gonna make me wanna go work out right now. This is fantastic. The laces have both of our names on.
That's right. They wanted me to remind you who gave it to you.
Oh. Oh, that's so nice. Oh, this is really customized. They put my favorite tree on the inside sole.
Tree on the inside. That's right. This box, we bought they were tearing down a school, and we bought the gymnasium floor for special projects, and we made this box out of a gymnasium floor. And it kind of has our motto, there is no finish line. And also our favorite quote from you says, I still have my feet on the ground, I just wear better shoes.
Oh, that's great.
Thank you.
That is great.
And we wanted to make sure that everybody in the crowd also has a pair of lunar glasses.
Yeah.
That's great.
When you say waffle, it
was literally made in a waffle,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we'd had a discussion with Bill Bowerman, the track coach that became my partner, and we said the running shoe hasn't had a new outer sole in 50 years. So he was thinking about it when he was driving back to Eugene, and on a Sunday his wife was making waffles, and he said, maybe that's it. And that was the start of the sole. And actually this last year, the International Inventors Hall of Fame just named Bowerman as a member of their Hall of Fame for the waffle sole.
Originally, you had this beginning shoe, the first one you were going to try. You send it to him in the hope that he might tell you it's a good shoe, give you the courage to go on, and then
what I really wanted from him was an order. And so he called and said, let's have lunch. And we had lunch up in Portland when he was up there with his team for a track meet. And so I thought that was a good sign. And so I had my order pad with me. And he said, how about letting your old coach be a partner with you? And I was stunned. And but before I could finish my hamburger, I said, by all means.
So you had yourself a partner.
So I had a partner.
But he had an interesting way.
I had more partners than inventory.
He had an interesting way to approach the partnership because he didn't want a 50-50 partnership.
He wanted me to have operating control, absolutely.
Mm. So that was a good thing. Mm. So he's the first one on the team.
Mm-hmm.
Who's next up?
Basically, another odd character named Jeff Johnson.
Who, really odd character.
Yes, very much so. And is odd to this day, living as a hermit. He makes J. D. Salinger look social, but he lives not far from where J. D. Salinger lives, on the near Vermont in Western New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, Bowerman is kind of your technological innovator and gives you the credibility, and Johnson is the ultimate salesman in a way.
He basically, more than anything else, he believed in running more than anything in his whole life, and runners and running equipment, and he was just totally into it. So yes, that made him a great salesman. But I don't know if he'd have been a great salesman with encyclopedias, which I had failed at earlier, or insurance, if you will, but he was a great shoe salesman.
Do you think that's important to
Absolutely.
Be passionate about the product?
I think it's everything.
Yeah. I think a lot of entrepreneurs would share that view. So who joins next?
And then basically next came Waddell. Mm-hmm. That Bill Bowerman called me that Bob Waddell was an outstanding long jumper on his team who had broken his back in a freak accident and would be confined to a wheelchair the rest of his life. And Bowerman said, you know, he's thinking about being a track coach. I don't think that's going to work. How about giving him a job? And so I met him for lunch and was taken with him. And he became kind of the great administrator of the group.
Right. And then I think one last member.
No, the two others, Del Hayes, right. The accountant I had worked with at Price Waterhouse, who became probably the best shoe manufacturing guy in the world. And then Rob Strasser, who was really kind of the distinguished himself as a lawyer in our early lawsuit problems, and then was really an outstanding marketing guy as well.
So this incredible team is at the core of this adventure that you're going to be on.
But let me interrupt to say, I don't know if they were geniuses or near geniuses, but they had all the emotional baggage of genius.
And what did that end up creating for you, that emotional baggage?
Well, it became a very odd environment, but it was one that basically the five of us thrived in. And because we were kind of misfits in a lot of ways, but we bonded together, because of that.
Mm-hmm. What was that glue? Was it the passion for running? Was it a certain
The belief in the product and the belief of where the company could go, but more than anything, it was a belief in each other.
And you became close to him. How did you get him to wear your shoes?
We worked at it and worked at it and worked at it. That he had worn Adidas his whole life, but he was right there in Eugene, and we had a small office in Eugene. And the guy that ran the office became his brother, practically, and ultimately convinced him to switch to Nike, and he was really our first real prominent track and field athlete.
You went after
sure.
others, and
sure.
how hard is it? You have to pay them to use your shoes, or they just like it so much they just use the shoes?
They all just like it so much they wear them.
Really?
No.
Okay.
No, I mean, obviously, if they're good enough, why they demand an endorsement fee from us or whoever they're going to wear. And, you know, I mean, other than Pre, I mean, the one that comes immediately to mind is Michael Johnson at the 96 Olympics in Atlanta, wore the gold shoes, which lifted us significantly.
And when you sign him up, he then wears your shoes exclusively, but you also then began to make golf equipment as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so you made golf balls and golf equipment, but now you're out of that business.
Mm-hmm.
Is that because you just want to focus on shoes and not other types of equipment?
It's a fairly simple equation. We lost money for 20 years on equipment and balls, and we realized next year wasn't going to be any different.
Okay, so you got out of that. So let me ask about basketball. In basketball, you had somebody named Michael Jordan as a basketball player you've heard of, right?
I've heard of him.
And so was it hard to sign him up, and why was his shoe so successful, became the most successful shoe ever in the athletic world?
Yeah, it was hard to sign him up because everybody wanted him. And we won that bid. We won that war. And
was it on your personality, or was
clearly.
It clearly not money? It's just personality.
No, we offered pretty good, but we had a lot of good players. We didn't have really great players, and we thought he had the chance to be that. He was obviously way better than we ever could have imagined. But yeah, when he started wearing the shoes, we made them really dramatic. They were red and black and white. They had three main colors, and of course. He was a very exciting player. He jumped and he was quick and he shot. He did everything well and he was handsome and he spoke well. And then the shoe was distinctive looking, and David Stern did us a huge favor. He banned it in the NBA. And so we ran a big ad that says banned in the NBA, and every kid wanted the shoe then. And,